today, I believe your speech is titled My Incredibly Normal Sexual Trauma. Is mm-hmm. that correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that sounds exciting. All right. Join me in welcoming you. Thank you, Amy.
My incredibly normal sexual trauma. If you've heard my other speech, which is called Where Can a Person Get True Sex Therapy, I basically say that I believe that pretty much everybody who grows up in a repressed sexual society has sexual trauma, because from repression comes violence. And so what happens is that the sexual force gets pressed down and it has to kind of shoot up and disturb us. And that either happens through overt ways like actual abuse, or more subtle ways like societal norms or media depictions of sexuality or cultural beliefs. So that's kind of where I'm coming from. Is I don't walk around identifying as a sexually traumatized person at all. I actually think I fall more on the other end of feeling sexually empowered. It's funny that I'm behind the podium today. I'm never behind the podium. I hate it back here, but I kind of need my notes. And yet, when I go back and look at my own sexual timeline, it's pretty clear that I have some pretty major sexual trauma. And I wonder how much most of us carry in that way and just repress, and we just walk around like normal people, and how much that repression keeps us from the great power of our sexuality. And this is what I feel like is the great disservice that happens in our culture, in the world, that we're divorced from our sexual power, which is like the actual basic life force. It's the thing that keeps humanity going. And I think it's the closest thing that we can have to a spiritual life. So I'm going to share with you today my very normal story. I'm just going to take you through my timeline. I'm just going to tell you my story. So my first kind of sexual memory starts at about 5 or 6 years old, when I had the realization, I had the awareness, the consciousness in my head, that when I grew up and I became a woman, I wanted to be good in bed. I'm 5 or 6 years old. If you know any 5 or 6 year olds, can you even imagine them having that be their goal for their future, that they be good in bed? Where did this come from? You know, the only things I can think of are my relationship with my father and observing how he was with women and how he talked about women or acted towards women, media, and the images in media. And there was one time when I saw, I think I was more like 7, when I saw an R-rated movie. I got snuck into an R-rated movie and I saw like a 30-second sex scene. And this woman clearly was nothing like me, and she was very sexual, and I thought I was probably supposed to be like her when I got older. I can't even tell you the scene, but really it was like 30 seconds long. And that made this lifelong impression of me, on me, this woman, seeing this woman in the scene. 30 seconds exposure. When I was 10, I remember being, this is the first time I've ever told anybody this, anybody at all in my whole life. I was with my stepsister, and I'm like starting to fidget with my face. And I told her that I made up a lie, and I told her that I've gone to third base with one of her friends. I was 10, and I was like lying about this like sexual experience that I had had, because it was so important to me that the world knew that I was good in bed, whatever that meant. So I've been holding that lie, actually, like really all my life, that I've carried that, that I said that. Then when I was 12, so now I'm kind of moving into puberty, my mom gave me this book. book or I stole a book from my mom or something and it had an explicit sexual scene in it. And I was so excited to find out like actually what women were like, at least in this book. And this woman, I remember this, I could even remember myself reading this thing out loud and taping it onto a tape recorder. But, oh gosh, it's so funny that that memory is coming back to me right now. But the image was of this woman with her back arched, like she's in a back bend, and liquid spurting out of her, right? This is her orgasm, right? So now I know what it's supposed to be like. I know what's supposed to happen. So I got all my supplies. I got towels. I covered my bed with towels. I got baby oil. And I I locked the door. And I started, and it took me like maybe a half an hour until I peed all over my bed. And it just was not very exciting. It was very wet, that part happened, but I like never had the actual like experience. So that was like a little bit of a kind of a, I don't know how to do this, and how am I ever going to be good in bed? I'm just peeing, you know. Okay, then when I was 14, then I had a group of friends, and people were starting to be sexual. And so here's my opportunity, although I did not feel very attractive, so I didn't know how I was going to make this work. But I thought alcohol could help, right? So we're at this party, and we're all drinking, and I had however much alcohol I had. And I wound up in some dark bedroom, somebody's bedroom, with some boy, and his finger wound up inside me. And it was like the most horrifying feeling ever. It actually really hurt. I was like not at all feeling sexual, I'm sure. I just, in my mind, I just wanted to be good in bed, so I had to get this thing going on. And so I just remember this kind of like unconscious finger, you know? And the weirdest thing is that when I was putting the speech together, I have no idea who that boy was. Like there's no face to that finger. There's no name that is attached to that finger. I have no idea who that was. I forgot to say this is a slightly graphic presentation. I hope that's okay. It'll keep going. I know that that finger created physical trauma in my body, right? But I don't know if we can call that rape or assault. We were two kids kind of in a dark room drinking, and this is just a very normal thing that happens. And the kind of worst thing about this experience was that I'm sure I was making noises that made it sound like I was having a good time because I wanted to be good in bed. And people who are good in bed enjoy this kind of thing. That woman in that 30-second clip was really enjoying whatever violent thing was happening to her. She was making those sounds. So I'm sure I was making these sounds that completely contradicted my actual experience. But pain and pleasure are kind of close. You know, the sounds can be kind of close. So it's kind of easy to fake pleasure. So this is when I started actually actively pretending and posing as this person who was good in bed. At 16, I actually fell in love. I had a boyfriend, and we had sex, and we had lots and lots of sex, and that was really exciting. I was like finally like really like in bed with somebody. And all I knew at the time was that we should probably be doing a lot of variety. We should probably be having sex in lots of different places, and I don't remember that much from this time, except for that after a while we had so much sex that I still didn't know whether or not I was good in bed because it was just with one person. And it seemed like being good in bed is an assessment that has to come from a group of people, right? Like that, like everybody has to agree, oh, Amy, she's good in bed. So how could my one boyfriend ever be the one? So I cheated on my boyfriend to find out more whether or not I was good in bed. And I cheated on him and I slept with somebody else who wound up actually raping me in the end. And it was a horrifying experience, actually. It was an anal rape, and I was saying no, but my no was kind of a conflicted no. And because I wanted to be good in bed, and how was I going to be good in bed if I was saying no? I'm using this good in bed thing a lot right now. It was very much in the background of my psychology. It wasn't like I was really sitting there thinking, about being good in bed. But now that I look back on it, it's very much the theme. Anyway, after he was done, I kind of scrambled to get out of there, and he was like at the kitchen table with his friends, and they all laughed at me as I ran out the door. So they had like clearly been talking about it, and he was bragging about it, and there was a little humiliation thing that happened there. So it's just really difficult for me. I still don't know if I'm good in bed, right? How will I ever find out? After that, I had several different relationships and different kinds of sex and sex with a variety of people. But one thing that I never, ever, almost ever tuned into in all these experiences was actually my own experience. And this is where it's just very difficult, is that sex was very much a performance. And I think that the underlying desire is that I would have a power where I could choose a partner, where I could actually, if everybody agreed that I was good in bed, then I would then have the choice of who I wanted to be my partner because everybody wanted to be with me. However, I was like never having my own actual authentic experience. When I was about 26, I actually got into a relationship with somebody who was very open and very loving, and he absolutely adored me, and I could do no wrong, and I turned him on incredibly. And so that was like finally I found out that like at least with him I really was good in bed. I felt really free, I felt really expressive. We were wildly sexual, it was so fun. But then we had other problems. So getting out of that relationship, I kind of got back into other relationships where I was kind of back into a more of a performer mode. But what I did find was that I could be a healer, that I could hold space for other people's sexual expansion. I could very much easily show up for them to explore and experience and feel held and feel safe. But I still didn't really have this experience of myself sexually. Even though I had a really good open time in this one relationship, it felt kind of isolated, like that was more about him and the space that he could hold than me and what I brought and how I felt in myself as a sexual being. So this last summer, I met somebody who is a sexual healer, and we started a relationship, and I had just that most absolute profound experience of one-way touch, of being a person who just could lie and receive, who could just be there, and my coach, he's called a coach, a sex coach, and he knows all of my fears, he knows all of my patterns, all of my my traumas. He knows my whole sexual story, and he's there completely to serve me. And this was like such a profound experience for me to just receive sexual attention and have it be all about me and all about my pleasure. And we're not in a relationship, so I'm not trying to turn him on. I'm not trying to get him to think anything about me. It's just about me and my sexuality. And that doesn't happen in a relationship. You know, in a relationship, you're doing things for and with each other, and what you do affects the other person, and it's not just one way. And so this relationship really transformed something in me that made me feel like this is the ultimate form of sexual healing, is one person holding space, a professional non-relationship person, or a not, let's just say a non-relationship person, holding the space for somebody else's sexuality, for me, felt like the only way to really get into my personal trauma. And so that sent me on this path of feeling like that was what I would like to do, is be able to provide that as a service. But it's actually illegal to do it for money because it would be considered sex work. And so I come to Toastmasters to try to work out my thoughts and feelings about this whole thing. And can I make a dent in the world? And can I put something out there that moves people, that helps people access their own trauma and realize what a gift it could be if we could train people to be sexual healers as a profession? So that's my deepest hope, is that all of us who have normal or extreme sexual trauma would have a place that we could go and work on it instead of just having to get lucky and manifesting a relationship with somebody who can hold that.